Good afternoon to everyone. So this topic was actually radiation and cancer biology. I am audible to everyone, I think so.
Yes, Vikas.
Yes. Okay.
So regarding the first abstract, that was sensitive detection of MSI or MMR in liquid biopsies. So I will ask Dr. Ashutosh Gupta sir from Jammu. Okay, sir, what do you think that there will be a difference between the liquid biopsy and the actual biopsy specimen with respect to this MSI instability or MMR detection? You are there, sir? Yes, sir. Sir, you are...
Dr. Ashutosh?
I'm here. Are you audible now? Yes.
Yes, Dr.
Ashutosh. Good afternoon. Actually, so nice meeting all of you. Dr. Manoj, not a long time. All my other friends also. So as far as my knowledge about liquid biopsy is concerned, as a clinician, when we discussed with our colleagues and especially from the lab side, sensitivity and specificity is that we ask for. And my take is that if you do liquid biopsy, assess the specificity, sensitivity, they are putting something about 70% vis-a-vis, you know, having a tissue. It's not bad actually. So if tissue is not available, I'll put liquid biopsy seems to be something around 70%. Is that what you wanted to ask me?
Yes, sir. And that has been done in like most of the lung cancer patients nowadays to get a liquid biopsy when the samples are inadequate. That has been done. And regarding the MSI, so most of this cancer, it is done in early stage colon cancer. So if the MSI is high, then probably they can go away without chemotherapy.
It's a favorable prognosis, yes.
Yeah. So do you routinely do MSI testing for all this colon cancer? Because it is not so easily available in each and every part of country.
Yeah. So, you know, availability is there. You know, you have now labs, you know, all the labs are there. We have opened up their outlets at most of the cities. So that's not a problem. But problem is that, see, again, one thing is affordability, second, you're tuning for that, actually. Are you really tuned for that? So I don't think economics should be a problem, but I think we are not at the moment, most of us are sensitized about it. So I think in future practice, I think these are becoming more and more common now. So at the moment, as the patient's coming or now, so I will insist them to have MSI done. And if you convince them, most of the patients are getting it done. So my new patients, actually, I'm advising them and they are getting it done.
Sir, you are doing it into the screenings also? Like if you have a polyp detected and...
Not at all. Actually, recently, I had a patient who had multiple polyps in the large intestine. He was 17-year-old boy. And he was one polyp appearing after another after polypectomy. So basically, you know, then I sent him to surgeon. Advised totalphylectomy and total prophylectomy, but as far as you know, this is not our field to find. You have to send to a genetic expert actually. So this is not my field. We treat only. We only advise those patients who have established disease, and if the tissue is available, we do advise. I do advise MSI testing now.
So mostly these MSI testings are done to advise the chemotherapy in stage 2 cancers. And then mostly to for the patients who can receive immunotherapy or not, like pembrolizumab or nivolumab.
So, you know, if you have the testing done only, then you can advise all these things actually.
Yeah, definitely, sir.
Already also we are getting it done now with PD-L1 testing actually.
Thank you, sir. Regarding our second abstract, that was the detectable HPV ctDNA circulating DNA in the post-operative.
Okay.
Hello.
Now we are getting.
Yeah, yes, sir. So second aspect was circulating DNA in the head and neck cancer, oropharyngeal cancer patients. So obviously, oropharyngeal cancer with HPV DNA is a good prognostic factor. But are we really going to change the practice depending on the circulating DNA methods at present? My question will be to Dr. Nalini Rao. Madam, can you please elaborate?
Hello. I found this paper sort of average. ctDNA, HPV is not the biggest cause in India. First thing, it's more tobacco related. We, in our hospital, we do it. We do a lot of genomics. I must have it right in the beginning. But it is good to think of doing it in the post-op setting, but I don't think they've clarified as to when we should do it, how often we should do it, what is the timing, do you do it? Because, and most of these patients anyway go for adjuvant treatment. So they are trying to see whether they do need, if you can find a subset which doesn't need adjuvant treatment. I'm finding that difficult to conceive of. I know, and it's very early tumors which undergo curative surgery and no planned adjuvant treatment. In that small subset, maybe it will help.
So do you think those patients who had done a curative surgery and after that there are still a circulating DNA, HPV DNA detectable. So do you think that there could be a small micro circulating cells, tumor cells are present, and maybe you subject those patients to a higher modality like PET CT or maybe other imaging to detect if there are any meds. So can you, do you think that you can do that?
You know, I come from a center and we run a clinic for difficult cases. So we sort of routinely do it this way. And the surprising thing is probably because surgeons are more aggressive these days, we're seeing a lot of the recurrences happen very early, immediately almost after surgery. So maybe there is a role for this because the biology is changing. Somehow, you know, all the tumors are changing in their biology. So I'm sure there will be an evolving role. You know, all this, all the works have come from very good centers and I'm sure there is a very sound basis for it. So I think, yes, there is a role, but in India, presently, in our setting, I don't, among the papers that came in, this wasn't my favorite.
Okay. Anyway,
Dr. Jagtap, may I one thing?
Yes, sir.
See, my question is that it is mentioned that they did it pre-RT, pre-chemo and pre-surgery and pre-RT. If it is positive, if the ctDNA is there in pre operative setting, so then it will be treated like metastatic disease or it will be early stage disease if it is positive before surgery.
The staging is
will not change by, the treatment.
I don't think staging will change by detection of ctDNA.
Staging was done as per the AJCC staging.
What is the practical approach? And what is the practical approach?
It will not.
What will be the practical approach? If it is positive.
So basically what Dr. Nalini just said, that there may be a small group of patients, very early, stage patient where curative surgery was done and there was no indication of post-operative RT. But if you find after surgery, there is circulating tumor DNA, probably that may, if we get more strong evidence, may be one of the indication for post-operative RT to reduce the local recurrences. Because in this study, they have seen that not only distant metastasis, but local recurrences also increased if there is a circulating DNA. So that may be the small group of patients. Yeah. Am I right, Dr. Nalini?
Hello.
Yeah, Dr. Nalini, please.
Yes. Lovely to see you all. Dr. Manoj, congratulations on your new machine. And I'm happy to see all of you in the times of COVID. It's so lovely. Dr. Singh, you are asking me something?
Yeah, just I wanted to know about, even pre-operative setting, when it is positive, ctDNA is positive. So do you think to change your way of treatment?
Most of the cases, you need to have the mutation up front. So you do have to do a baseline thing. And only if that mutation is available in the baseline, then it makes sense to follow up these patients. At least that is my current understanding so far.
So it is going to change, I think.
I don't think it will change. It becomes a tumor marker kind of a thing, an expensive tumor marker. But if you don't have any other tissue for diagnosis, you can follow up. There's a very expensive way to follow them up, but we can follow up them with liquid biopsies instead of looking for it. And in case you need to, we are de-escalating in HPV. So I don't see the need for escalation of radiation dose. But if you have left disease immediately after surgery, or if you find anything else, maybe there is a reason, but I don't see anything except that small group which I alluded to.
See, if you find circulating DNA in a tumor stage, it will not change the staging at all.
No, it doesn't change.
Absolutely, because it doesn't mean the tumor is spreading out. It is throwing metastasis, isn't it?
Yeah.
So you should be very, very careful when you analyze the results. In clinical setting, will you change your treatment? See, your treatment will be guided more by other factors, postoperative, where nodes are positive, PNI, LVI, other things, rather than if surgical margins were clear or not, rather than going by circulating DNA.
TNA.
So we'll move out to our next abstract, sir. So our next abstract was the FOXO1 inhibition as a therapeutic strategy for radiation thrombosis. I would like to ask Srivastava, sir, Now he has been gone through Cobalt era, then again 3D-CRT, IMRT, and now to the advanced technology. Sir, what do you think is the most important factors where we can actually prevent the fibrosis in these patients? And how much the benefit really these inhibitors will have in future? Shivanto, sir? Yes. Sir, can you hear us, sir? Shivanto, sir?
Is he there?
Yes, sir, he is there, but I think...
Can you hear me?
Sir,
he's there, but I think he's not... What do you
mean? Dr. Shyam, I think you are muted. Can you unmute?
No, he's not muted.
He's roaming
around, probably. Maybe Dr. Thakwani, sir, can take it again, sir.
Can you please repeat what you were asking?
I was asking...
Very good afternoon to everybody.
Yeah, so we had you gone from the Cobalt era to the new machines with the IMRT, VMAT, everything.
Yeah.
So what is the most important factor that will affect the fibrosis? Is it the technology or is it the inhibitors are going to have a lot of changes in the fibrosis that we have at presently in our patients?
Yes, basically what I think is that both the things are very important. If we see the technology, we have come, we have progressed from the Cobalt era, where most of the tumor and around the structures which are nearby, they got radiation, and which results unnecessary radiation fibrosis. But as we progressed from IMRT to IGRT, then we were able to localize the treatment to the tumor only. So it has reduced, of course, reduced the radiation fibrosis. But if we see all these, like the inhibition of FOXO1, like thing, then definitely in the coming future, these type of the therapies definitely will help us in reducing further the radiation fibrosis.
Sir, any other products in the market where you think that the fibrosis is less? There are some products which are available in the market. So, is there any experience from your side that they are really helpful that we had given to some patient and they had less fibrosis? Because obviously the patient-wise, there is a lot of variation in the fibrosis even with the same dose, same plannings.
See, basically, there are a lot of products which are in the market which says themselves to be that they are effective. But in my practical experience, I don't think so there's any effect on the radiation fibrosis. But definitely, our technology, definitely when we have come from Cobalt to IGRT and IMRT, definitely it has proved good in reducing the radiation fibrosis.
So as of today, I think rather than the drugs available, the technology has more benefit in reducing the fibrosis rather than the drug. We'll wait for the result of FOX1 in the clinical trials where it will see whether we are still good.
We'll wait for that.
Yes, ma'am.
I tend to use a lot of drugs for, at least I use pentoxifilis, which is Trentham, 400 milligram twice a day with vitamin E, and I find it very useful. The issue has been tolerance, GI tolerance, particularly diarrhea with some patients. They go off and they come back, but I find it's very useful.
Okay.
And we tend to think of all our machines that help radiation fibrosis as subcutaneous fibrosis, but there's still a lot of tissue damage happening inside organs, which is going to be more and more with hypofractionation. So I think we have to look at radiation fibrosis drugs for it. It's my personal opinion.
That's what I tell you. It will take some time for us to observe these things. Because till today, I don't think so there's any significant role of these medicines.
Can I just add upon that? Actually, when we were young, there was a drug called amifostine. We were all familiar with it. It had a lot of promise. We attend so many conferences. It didn't work at all, you know. So what I mean to say is that additives with radiation, there's no substitute for a good technique. And you can use your own drugs and you can have a better experience, but they are not reproducible, ma'am. If you use a set of drugs and you try to reproduce most of them, you are unable to do that. So at the further time being, I think there are no additives which are radioprotective in some way or the other at the moment, maybe in future.
I think with Dr. Gupta here, I have to make a comment that all these days we taught the 4 R's and refer to the 5th R, intrinsic radiosensitivity. And now all this molecular biology, genomics is opening up that, and we're going to individualize and find out in a particular patient, what is it that causes a fibrosis? We may have universally come to a certain level, but I think we need to move further on this. My personal opinion, I would go further.
I'm not saying you should not move further, but at the moment, I think it is an infancy, whatever the drugs
it is, it is. I agree with that.
That's what I said.
Dr. Gupta, I fully agree with Dr. Jagtap. I fully agree with Dr. Gupta, because sometimes this fibrosis needs some advantage. Say, it is said when we go for 4 hour or 5 hour or now 6 hour,
you are not audible, Dr. Opie. You are not audible.
Sir,
Dr. Opie, you are not audible.
I think
you lost his signal.
He's connected. Okay.
You can go ahead, Dr. Vikas.
So our next abstract was. Yeah. Our next de novo purine synthesis in the ADH wild type glioma. Yes, sir. We can see you again. So, any of the expert panel can take it. How much difference do we observe between the IDH wild and IDH mutant type of GBMs? At present, we are treating them in the same way. So. Obviously, temozolomide is still the standard of care for so many years. So, do you think that this novel strategy will really change the survival aspect of GBM in the coming years?
Yeah, I would like to comment on this. Basically, IDH mutant. Basically, nowadays we are confused when we come up with a patient with a low grade glioma. So, low grade gliomas like grade 2. So, 1 or 2. So, when to give adjuvant therapies post-operatively. So, sometimes it becomes very difficult for us. So, then we come up to this IDH. If it is an IDH mutant, then I don't think so there's any need for any adjuvant therapy. But again, if there's no residual disease, of course. But if it is an IDH wild type, then definitely we should go ahead with the adjuvant therapy like radiation and temozolomide, even if it is grade 1 or grade 2. So, most of the time, what happens? Like if it is an IDH mutant in grade 4 also in GBM, then it is said that it is a secondary glioblastoma multiform which has come up from the lower grade gliomas. But if it is most of the time it is an IDH wild type only in a GBM. So this was the next point.
Okay. So what is your take on this new molecule MMF? MMF.
I couldn't get you.
So, what is the take on this new molecule which has been done for the purine synthesis downregulation?
You are talking about this IDH, huh?
Yeah, IDH only.
Basically, my takeoff is like if it is a mutant and the tumor like GB, this is a low grade glioma, like grade 2, then we can skip our adjuvant treatments. Okay, but if it is a wild type, then definitely, even if there's no residual disease and grade 2 gliomas also, so we should go ahead with the treatment, further adjuvant treatment like temozolomide and radiotherapy post-operatively.
Any other take on this?
What I saw was this mycophenolate mofetil is a immunosuppressant which is already being used for transplant, renal transplant immunosuppression. And if you look at the class of anti-metabolites, they were already addressing the purine and pyrimidine metabolism. So I don't know whether they're just revisiting or finding a subgroup of, IDH wild type who might benefit by this. But again, it's a bad disease. Every step forward is a step forward. Significant step forward is my take.
Yeah. So coming to the same, which like these drugs which are used in a transplant patient. So our next abstract was depending on that, the VISTA blockade immunotherapy with multi-modal approach. So where they had given cyclophosphamide along with radiation. So cyclophosphamide is also immunomodulator. And definitely that would have been some effect in these settings where the immunotherapy is used and they are probably immunomodulating these effects. That's why you see better tumor response and better patient outcomes in these patients. How the radiation is going to affect the immunotherapy? So any take on that? Maybe you or even Manoj Gupta sir can also take this question.
So basically, now there are a lot of experiments which are being conducted on immunotherapy along with radiation, especially in metastatic setting. So they just want to invoke immune response, with radiation so that these immunotherapy will not only work locally but also at distant sites, and it has been seen in many cohort of patients that when you give especially the moderate dose of radiation along with immunotherapy, they are not only able to reduce the disease at local site but also at distant sites. So again, this is present abstract is another step in this direction.
Yeah, so along with radiation, they had added an immunomodulator that was cyclophosphamide.
Yes.
Modulate the effects of immunotherapy and the results will be. The last abstract was presence of giant circulating cancer.
Add here, you know, you have to be, you know, concerned with the dose of radiation. It has to be high dose.
Yes,
you are talking about.
They had given 12 grade 2 divided doses.
That was two times. Yeah.
Good study to take, isn't it? Immunotherapy versus cyclophosphamide, the price difference.
So that was Dr. Panos sir was also saying high dose radiotherapy before for the metastatic diseases along with immunotherapy.
It brings in the abscopal effect which we are talking about with hypofractionation.
Yes, ma'am. So
what's the difference between immunotherapy versus cyclophosphamide? So it's
but Ashutosh, they have not not used the cohort where they are just using cyclophosphamide plus high dose of radiation. They have used the cyclophosphamide along with two immunotherapy.
Along with Vista and other.
We do not know what will be the effect if you give
single
along with radiation, right? So we do not know that.
And it will be more cheaper option if at all it helps.
Yeah, it helps.
The PD-1 and CTLA-4 got a Nobel Prize, so Vista might be in line for a Nobel Prize.
So regarding the last aspect, circulating cancer-associated macrophages has been studied in other cancers also, like breast cancer. There are many published studies, and they have been already think as a progression or the predictive biomarkers for most of these patients. But are we going to change our modality for adjuvant treatment if suppose that for a lung cancer patient, they had given a CTRT, squamous cell cancer, and the patient has residual disease with a more than 50 micron of macrophages still present. So are we going to consider adjuvant therapy straight away, or we are going to still assess them for a period of time and then consider treatment? Thakwani sir, can you please take this? Am I audible? Hello?
Yes, you are.
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes, you are.
Yes. So, see, basically, practically, if we see this size of the macrophage, so we don't take it into the account. But if we don't have any other clue, like any other like margins, if you see the margins or there's any radiologically reappearance of the disease, then definitely it can help us. If the patient general condition is good and if we see the this giant macrophages more than 50 micrometers, then definitely we should add some adjuvant treatment to it in a form of chemotherapy or this immunotherapy or radiation, whatever.
Yeah, because in the study they are also seen that those who had good responder, the macrophages below 50, more than 50 decrease slowly over a period of time. So they had
macrophages. So that is why if the more macrophages are being seen in the blood, then definitely we should go ahead with the treatment, because we already know that the prognosis is not that good in that case, and more chances of the progression of disease can be there.
It could be an easy method to do because it could be done in most of the laboratories without much issues.
Yes.
Some advanced technique. That is what.
Yes. But again, only I will say that this study only shows the prognostic effect of these macrophages. Right.
Yes.
So,
sir.
Unless we have evidence that when we treat these patients with adjuvant treatment, they have better outcome or not. So we need to do this trial first, and only then I think we can.
One more thing. What we can do is that we can keep these type of patients on a maintenance therapy or metronomic chemotherapy, what we call it. So it can help in the patient for the disease to come again. So this can be a solution to that.
It could be a new.
Yeah, what I'm trying to tell that before we bring this thing into practice, we should generate some data whether the if we give metronomic or maintenance chemotherapy in these patients, whether it's really going to help or not.
That's true, sir.
Data before we put into practice.
Yeah, it's true, sir.
Does it look Hello, Dr. Jagtap. Yes, my question is, does local therapy affect this size of giant cells? Local therapy, dose and surgical intervention and something. The effect of the macrophages size? Local therapy, local, so say it is in breast, suppose in breast, we are giving good radiotherapy. In that case, it is going to affect this.
Macrophages were associated with the tumor.
Giant macrophages?
Yes, sir. So these macrophages were associated with the tumor. So as the tumor size decreased, their the size, which were more than 50, also decreased slowly over a period of time. So those patients who had a very good response, their more than 50 micron cells also disappeared from this. Yeah, it will be less. But that will be affected.
That study should, that type of study should also be required, I think. Local therapy. Local therapy versus post-operative RT versus no RT. In that case, we can see later on.
In breast cancer, it has been done.
Yeah.
So maybe the results will be
any more fact. It is not published yet. No?
Any other questions? I think we are already over the time.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Dr. Neerajan, and thank you, Dr. Manoj, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Vikas Jagtap, for this interaction. And thanks, Neeraj, for giving us this opportunity to interact with our friends in COVID time. Thank you, Neeraj. Over to Neeraj. I think we.
Thank you, Neeraj.
Thank you, Dr. Manoj.